dedication to celebration. Lift your voices to praise the Lord God, because all his ways are just. You have promised to judge the world in righteousness and govern the people with justice. Therefore, we enter your presence this morning to honor you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, because all your ways are just. Hallelujah.
Verses 1 through 6, 13 through 18. And it reads, O Lord, Yahweh, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but O Lord, Yahweh, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast set me behind before, and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain unto it. For thou hast possessed my reins, thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. And in thy book all my members were written, which is in continuance with fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. How precious also art thou thought unto me, O God! How great is the sum of them! If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee. Hallelujah.
Let us now pray. Eternal Father in heaven, we come today to praise your name collectively. We come to give you thanks for who you are and for what you've done. Father, we just thank you today because you've been so good to us. We thank you, O Heavenly Father, because the things that we wanted, maybe you didn't give us, but the things that we needed, you gave us fully. So, Father, we just praise you today. We thank you, O Heavenly Father. We thank you for your word, O Heavenly Father, because we know in your word it says that you would never leave us nor forsake homes. We need you in our workplace. We just need you in the world, and we need you at church. So, Father, we thank you today, O Heavenly Father, because we realize that when our needs, we can call on your name. Father, you hear our prayers, O Heavenly Father. You hear our concerns, O Heavenly Father, and you answer. So we thank you today, O Heavenly Father, for doing all of that. Now we just ask a blessing upon this church, this assembly, our pastor, the sick, the shut-in, O Heavenly Father. And then, O Heavenly Father, we just ask for a blessing on those that have some doubt in their mind. But I'll let you know that even before the world, O Heavenly Father, Abraham had announced that he was a faithful man. And oh Heavenly Father, since you blessed him, you blessed all of us. And so we thank you today, oh Heavenly Father. We give you the praise and honor. In your name we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This being the first Sabbath of the month, let us all stand as we remember our church covenant. Having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of Yah to receive the Lord Yahshua HaMashiach as our Lord, as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we do now in the presence of Yah and this assembly most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. To strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort. To sustain its worship, ordinances, disciplines, and doctrines. We also engage to maintain as far as possible family and secret devotion. To seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances. To be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, exemplary in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. To aid each other in sickness and distress. To be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation, and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure without delay. Hallelujah. You may be seated.
Testament, our New Testament scriptures coming from the book of Jeremiah, or Old Testament scripture, I'm sorry. Jeremiah 18, verses 1 through 11. Again, our Old Testament scripture is Jeremiah 18, verses 1 through 11. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words." Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on wheels. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again, another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as the potter?" Said the Lord, "Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in my hand, O house of Israel. At what instant I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to pluck up and to pull down and to destroy it, if that nation against whom I have pronounced turn from their evil, I will repent from the evil that I thought to do unto them. And at what instant and at what instance I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to build up and to plant it. If I do evil in my sight, if it do evil in my sight, then that did obey not my voice, then I will repent of the good where I said I would do benefit them. Now, therefore, go to speak to men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, thus said the Lord, behold, I frame evil against you and devise a device against you. Return ye now every one from his evil way and make your ways and your doings good. Hallelujah.
The New Testament comes from the book of Philemon, the first chapter, the only chapter, verses 1 through 21. Again, the book of Philemon, verses 1 through 21. This letter is from Paul, a prisoner for preaching the good news about Christ Yeshua, and from our brother Timothy. I'm writing to Philemon, our beloved co-worker, and our sister Apphia, and our fellow soldier Archippus, and to the church that meets in your house. May Yah, our Father, and the Lord Yeshua HaMashiach give you grace and peace. I always thank my God when I pray for you, Philemon, because I keep hearing about your faith in the Lord Yeshua and your love for all of Yah's people. And I'm praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Your love has given me much joy and comfort, my brother, for your kindness has often refreshed the hearts of God's people. That is why I'm boldly asking a favor of you. I could demand it in the name of Christ because it is the right thing for you to do. But because of our love, I prefer simply to ask you. Consider this as a request from me, Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner for the sake of Christ Yeshua. I appeal to you to show kindness to my child Onesimus. I became his father in the faith while here in prison. Onesimus hasn't been of much use to you in the past, but now he is very useful to both of us. I'm sending him back to you, and with him comes my own heart. I wanted to keep him here with me while I'm in chains and preaching the good news, and he would have helped me on your behalf. But I did not want to do anything without your consent. I wanted you to help because you were willing, not because you were forced. It seems you lost Onesimus for a little while, so that you can have him back forever. He is no longer like a slave to you. He is more than a slave, for he is a beloved brother, especially to me. Now he would mean much more to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you will welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge it to me. For I, Paul, write this letter with my own hand. I will repay it, and I won't mention that you owe me your very own soul. Yes, my brother, please do me this favor. For the Lord's sake, give me this encouragement in Christ. I am confident as I write this letter that you would do what I ask and even more. Hallelujah.
Good morning, New Covenant. God bless you today. Such a blessing to be back in the house of the Lord this first Sabbath of a new month. We continue to praise him for all of his many graces and mercies towards each and every one of us. To all of you who are here today, we just thank you for your presence. It's always an awesome event to come together and praise the name of the Most High for all that he's doing for us. For those that are live streaming with us on Facebook, we thank you for taking the time, and we hope that something is said that will bless you and that will nourish your spirit on today. And now as we continue in our worship service, we want to invite you to say hello to your neighbor, give a hand wave, a fist bump as we conduct our peace fellowship. God bless you.
clothes giveaway on the 16th. So you can start bringing your clothes in on the Sabbath, and we will distribute them on the 16th. Thank you.
We are so wonderful, blessed to have a Father who loves us in spite of ourselves, and who always invites us to invoke his name and call on him in prayer. You've heard the announcements. I don't need to go through those. You've read them, and just govern yourselves accordingly. At this time, we will have our corporate prayer for the saints, for those who are convalescing, those who are ill and afflicted, who need prayer. As we call those names out, we can bring them to the throne of grace and ask Father Yah's blessing, healing, and deliverance upon those whom you bring to his altar today. At this time, the prayers of the people. Webster family. That she over there? Hallelujah. Praise him. All right. Anyone? Gavin? Bless you. Bless you. Aria Mimes, yes. Jackson? Glover, okay. Let us also remember Brother Chambers in our prayers, Brother Bill and Prasant and Bill Wiley in our prayers. Let us remember Leo Moore, Sister Dyson, then our senior members, Sister Habit, Sister Rucker, remember Sister Frazier, Sister Loggins, and all of our brothers and sisters, some we have not seen in a while, they are still at home. We know that Father Yah is a prayer-hearing God. We thank him for the delivery of Brother and Pastor Stephen Lewis, bringing him through his surgery. We pray that Father Yah continue to bless him and strengthen him physically and bless his ministry. And then we want to lift up our young, our children, our young adults. As we go to the throne of grace, let us remember them in our prayers and thank Father Yah that he is a prayer-hearing God, that he has all power in heaven and earth in his holy hands. No illness, no anything that is beyond his power to do. Let us also remember Sister Doris Green in our prayer, that Father Yah will bless her through this ordeal that she is experiencing. Sister Emma Harris, remember her. Now, as we go to the throne of grace, let us remember we serve an awesome God. Most gracious and loving Father Yah, we come with thanksgiving and praise in our lips and our hearts, thanking you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. Thanking you for what you have brought us from, what you have brought us through. No one but you, Father Yah, is capable of transforming our circumstances of gloom and defeat, celebration of praise and thanksgiving. You have heard the names of those whose name has been brought before your divine holy presence. You already know their condition before we even utter the word. You know our thoughts from afar off. But Father Yah, bring healing and deliverance to every name, every person, every infirmity. Heal and deliver. Oh, Father Yah, forgive sins and iniquities. Transform our lives into what you would desire it to be. that it be of a constant reflection of your grace, your mercy, the consciousness that our lives would truly be reflective of what Christ said we are, lights, salt. We pray for our children. We pray for these young adults. Guide them and undergird them, Father Yah, with your holy word, because it is your word, Father Yah, that's going to bring transformation. Not social media. Know anything. It is your word. Help them to make your word a light unto their path, a lamp unto their feet. Oh, Father Yah, bless now. Heal and deliver. And we also are sending out a special prayer for the Watkins today as they funeralize their son. Comfort them as only you can do. Bless, continue, Father Yah, to guide them and help them to know that, yes, you know the brokenhearted. You're close to them who are crushed in spirit. So, Father Yah, have your way now in our lives. Guide us in all that we do. Forgive us from sins and iniquity. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness, whether thought or in deed. Now, Father Yah, as we continue in the Shabbat, guide us that our worship will indeed be in spirit and in truth. Spirit with the consciousness of you. Truth with sincerity. According to what you have determined what worship should be. Bless us now. We thank you for Sister Dillard, who made this trip here today, who visited with us. Bless her continuously. Now, Father Yah, hear our prayer. Incline thy ear to us. Grant us your peace. In the name of Yahshua the Mashiach, our Savior and Redeemer, and all the saints said, Hallelujah.
New Covenant. The gospel reading this morning comes from St. Luke, chapter 14, verses 25 through 33. Luke 25:33. A large crowd was following Jesus as he turned around and said to them, "If you want to be my disciple, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else, your father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. And if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. But don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there is enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, 'There's that person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it.' Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him? And if he can't, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own." Hallelujah. Thank you.
thanksgiving, praise, and our lips. Prepare our hearts now to be receptive to your holy word. Your word is spirit, your word is life. Oh, Father, it's through the preaching of the gospel you have chosen to transform humanity. We pray now, Father, you give us open, receptive hearts and mind to receive that which you desire to give. Give me, the preacher, the ability to stand in this sacred place, spiritually anointed, empowered physically to stand and preach your holy word. Now, your word is spirit. Yes, it is life. Father, we know that salvation come by hearing, and hearing come by and through your word. Bless now. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It is in the glorious and the precious name of Yahshua, the Messiah, our Savior. With thanksgiving we pray. Hallelujah. Listen now unto the words of the Most High. Jeremiah 18, verses 1 through 11. Jeremiah 18, 1 through 11.
Yah gave another message to Jeremiah. He said, "Go down to the potter's shop, and I will speak to you there." So I did as he told me and found the potter working at his wheel. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he had hoped. So he crushed it into a lump of clay again and started over. Then Yah gave me this message, "O Israel, can I not do to you as this potter has done to his clay? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand. If I announce that a certain nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, but then that nation renounces its evil ways, I will not destroy it as I had planned. And if I announce that I will plant and build up a certain nation or kingdom, but then that nation turns to evil and refuses to obey me, I would not bless it as I said I would. Therefore, Jeremiah, go and warn all Judah and Jerusalem. Say to them, this is what Yah says. I am planning disaster for you instead of good. So turn from your evil ways, each of you, and do what is right."
Clay in the potter's hand, shaping evil against a disobedient people. Hallelujah. Clay in the potter's hand, shaping evil against a disobedient people. As indicated by the opening verses, Father, your people, Judah, has a problem with disobedience. Thus, the Lord says, Father, your gave another. That word another indicates something previously given but not comprehended or received. So the Lord, Father Yah, gave another message to Jeremiah. He said, God, go down to the potter's shop and I will speak to you there. Go down to the potter's shop. Take that D off of God there. That's go down to the potter's shop, and I will speak to you there. He gave him another message. Judah, proclivity towards disobedience. They have a problem. So much so that, Father, y'all have to be repetitive in instructing his people. Family, think about it. Father, y'all could have spoken to Jeremiah right on the spot, from the very start. However, that was not his intentions for him to receive the message to give to Judah, his people. Instead, Father, y'all wanted Jeremiah to go down to the potter's shop. Think about it, family. Going down to the potter's shop, going down is an humiliating or a humbling assignment. Going down, perhaps indicating that he was up near the temple, but going down, that's a humbling assignment. Going to the potter's shop was to be for Jeremiah a place for hearing, obedience, and learning. Think about it, family. Some of the most mundane life experiences can become the most valuable teaching lessons and moments. Going down, observing a potter at his wheel. It's a mundane experience. This is something that he did on a daily basis. But some of the most mundane experiences of life can teach the most valuable lessons. Listen to verse 3 and 4 now. So I did as he told me and found the potter working at his wheel. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he has hoped. So he crushed it into a lump of clay again and started over. Pottery, man, can be a frustrating experience. Because sometimes the thing you're working on don't always turn out as you intended. Brothers and sisters, Father Yah wanted Jeremiah to experience this potter, because this becomes then, for Jeremiah, a parable presenting an object lesson to teach or reveal divine truth. See, Father Yah was illustrating to Jeremiah his sovereignty over nations and people. See, the potter power over the clay, it represents Father Yah's power over Judah, that he would do what? Continue to shape, reshape, and mold his disobedient people into useful vessels, like the potter created power over the clay on his wheel. Yes, he continually to mold his people. Why? Because clay is always in the potter's hand. He cannot remove his hand from the clay. If he does, whatever he is making is ruined. So his hands must always be on the clay. The potter's power over the clay represents Father Yah's power over your life, over the life of Judah. And guess what? Because the clay is in his hand, he does what? He continues to reshape and mold his disobedient people into useful vessels, like the potter created power over the clay. And sometime the clay or the vessel must be crushed into a lump so he may start over. But that's his power. That's his prerogative. Because he is the potter over the clay, his power to shape, reshape, and to mold not only the life of Judah, but our lives. We are clay in the potter's hand. And the clay must always be in his hand if it is to be transformed into a useful vessel. However, Judah has issues. They have a propensity towards sin, idolatry, and disobedience. But think about it, family. It's only when Judah, through an act of repentance, will they be of value and worth to the Heavenly Father. Brothers and sisters, on the potter's wheel, defects appear, and it signaled to the potter the need to reduce the lump of clay or the clay or the vessel into a lump of clay. Why? Because the potter has power over the clay. Yes. See, the clay on the potter's wheel can manifest imperfections. And if it has imperfection, its value diminishes. Think about it. If he allows this vessel with imperfection to be placed on the market, not only would its value be diminished, but it speaks volume about the potter's creative genius and craftsmanship. Brothers and sisters, only when our lives are in the Heavenly Father's hand will we experience the dynamics of created spiritual living. That's one of my life lessons. Only when our lives are in the Heavenly Father's hand will we experience the dynamics of creative spiritual living, sharing lives, reshaped for his divine purpose. Remember, the clay is always in the potter's hand. And only when your life, my life, only when our lives are in the Heavenly Father's hand will we ever experience the dynamics of created spiritual living, sharing our lives, reshape for his divine purpose. Listen to verse 4. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he hoped, so he crushed it into a lump of clay and started over. There was something in the clay that prevented it from being made into the vessel that the potter had intended. Remember, as the quality of clay, as it limits what the potter can do with it, so the quality of our lives limit what Father Yah can do with us. As the quality of the clay. Bad clay is difficult to transform it. So it's only as the quality of the clay exists can the potter really do something creative and ingenious with the clay. So too our lives, the quality of our lives, it limits what Father Yah can do with us. If we're disobedient, if we are just insistent on being contrary, being irreverent, disobedient, disagreeable, it limits what he can do with our lives. quality of people limits what the Heavenly Father can do with them. Father, y'all, brothers and sisters, because clay is always in the potter's hand, he sees what we can become. He sees what we can't see in our lives. How many of you ever really seen yourself? You have never seen yourself. All you ever have seen is a reflection in a mirror. It takes me to tell you about that imperfection on the side of your ear. You didn't see that this morning. It takes me to tell you, oh, your lipstick's not on properly. You've never seen yourself. None of us have. All we ever have seen is a reflection. It takes someone else to see what we cannot see. Father, Yah sees what we cannot see in our lives. But he also sees what we can become. Like clay on the sacred wheel of God's creation. He alone, family, sees our imperfection and provide the power to help us live redeemed lives in compliance to his word, will, and purpose. Oh, hallelujah. On the sacred wheel of God's creation, he alone sees our imperfection. You think you all of that. But Father, y'all see something different. You know, sometimes we get self-righteous and all puffed up with our sense of holiness. Isaiah said, man, all of our effort is nothing but filthy rags. Yes, but on the sacred wheel of God's creation, he alone sees our imperfection. But he doesn't leave us there. He provides the power to help us to live redeemed lives in compliance to his word, will, and purpose. On our own, man, we are incapable of responding to divine truth. This is what's wrong with the church today, because we really don't want the word. We want to be entertained because we don't want to think or ponder that word or to examine that word or have that word examine our lives. So we would rather be entertained so we don't have to think to become. So just shout us out. Just go on and cut across the field and go to your hoop, man, so we can go home. But if you're clay in the potter's hand, on the sacred wheel of God's creation, oh, he is trying to show you our imperfection, your imperfection, because he wants to provide you the power, because he does not want you to become a defective vessel. That means servant. He wants you to be empowered. That is why not only does he point out the imperfection, but then he provides you the power. That's very important, family. Providing the power. See, that's grace. And grace is the power of God helping you to become and do what you cannot by yourself. On your best day, man, you mess up. On your way to church, in church, you mess up. We all need his grace. We all need him to provide the power to help us live redeemed lives, because on our own, we can't. Because if you cross us, catch us, you may not like what come out of our lips. Come on now. Come on now, fess up. One aspect of clay. Well, actually, it's two aspects, and they are mindless and lifeless. Yes. The aspects of clay, mindless, lifeless. And think about it. That is what life is like. Without the shaping power of God. reshaping us into functional and for his functional and spiritual purposes. Yes, clay is mindless. Clay is lifeless. It's an inanimate thing. Yet, this is what life is like without the shaping power of God, reshaping us into his functional and spiritual purposes. As we surrender our lives, family, to his purpose, he does what? He transforms us into valuable, righteous vessels, meaning servant. And I believe part of the problem with the church, we have not surrendered to his shaping power to transform our natural tendency into his functional and spiritual purposes. See, our natural tendencies is always contrary to the divine ways of the Most High. I don't naturally just want to just love. I don't naturally just want to behave in a proper way. It is for the Yah within that transform. Yes, altering my natural tendency. Do you always want to do right? Do you always do what is right? Do you always say what is right? No, we don't. We mess up daily. That is why we need what? The transforming power of God to reshape us into functional and spiritual purposes. And that can only be done when we surrender our hearts, our mind to his purpose so that he may do what? Transform, making us valuable and righteous servant. Listen to verse 5 and through 10. Listen what it says. Then the Lord Yah gave me this message. O Israel, can I not do to you as the potter has done to his clay? As the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand. If I announce that a certain nation or kingdom is to be rooted up, torn down, and destroyed, but then the nation renounces its evil ways, I will not destroy it as I had planned. And if I announce that I will plant and build up a certain nation or kingdom, but that nation turns to evil and refuses to obey me, I will not bless it as I said I would. Remember, the potter never takes his hand off the clay. Aren't you glad that Father Yah never takes his hands off of our life? Father Yah loves humanity. Think about it. While we were yet lost, what did he do? Sent Christ. And Christ did what? Died for us to become what? The greatest intercessor known to the world. Adam and Eve failed. Noah and his family, they failed. The Tower of Babel. Then you got Israel. Disinherited the nations, but kept Israel at his inheritance. Gave them a law, gave them a covenant, gave them the ministry of reconciliation. They messed up, turned to idolatry, doing that which was contrary to the divine will and way of God, leading to their exile and captivity. Now, what would Father Yah do with this dilemma? The dilemma of clay that seemingly have imperfections So the invisible God had to become visible in Christ so that he can do what? Impute our sins in him so that his righteousness may be imputed in us. That's the only way, brothers and sisters, you can ever have a saving or a reconciling relationship with the Heavenly Father. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He imputed our sins in Christ, and his righteousness was imputed in us. We call that double imputation. Remember, the clay is always in the potter's hand. Father God, however, limits his sovereign actions based on the response of the people. Say that again. He limits his sovereign actions based on the response of the people. If I announce that a certain nation of kingdom is to be uprooted and torn down and destroyed, but the nation renounces evil ways, I will not destroy it. His sovereign action are based on the response of the people. But if I announce that I would plant and build up a nation of kingdom, but that nation turns to evil and refuses to obey, that's what he says. I will not bless it as I said I would. His sovereign actions are based on the response of the people. However, because of Judah's transgressions, he vows to shake evil against his disobedient people. Why? Because his sovereign actions are based on the response of the people. Now, if Judah wants to escape captivity and punishment, they only have one choice. Do what? Repent. But listen to what Father Yah says about his people. Let's look at Isaiah 1 and 3 and Jeremiah 4 and 22. Listen to what he says in Isaiah. Even an ox knows its owner, and a donkey recognizes its master's care, but Israel doesn't know its master. Oh, man, what an indictment. What an indictment. My people don't recognize my care for them. Listen to Jeremiah. My people are foolish and do not know me, says the Lord. They are stupid children who have no understanding. They are clever enough at doing wrong, but they have no idea how to do right. Oh, snap. This is an indictment. When we look at the current state of our people, God, Father, Yah, chosen people, it indicates that our people don't recognize his care for them. Right now, many resemble defective clay, unsuitable, Father, Yah's eternal purpose. And our only hope as a people in reversing this current condition and experiencing divine transformation is to repent and turn back to Father Yah in obedience. You see, turn back. If not, we're going to continue seeing and experiencing the escalation of violence, perversion, and lostness. It's not going to get better. Trust me. Christ even said, as in the days of Noah, so it shall be when the Son of Man returns. It's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. Our children are lost partly because young adults don't bring them to church anymore. And the church basically becoming a senior citizen home. We didn't have that choice when I came up as a kid. And Dad and Mama got dressed, you better be already dressed and ready to go. They took us so we could be instructed in the word and in the nurture of Father Yah's holy word. But somehow we've got modern now. And now they're out of control. I've never seen such wild, unbehaving, unruly, degenerate. I've never seen anything like this. Our schools are just a dance of iniquity, man. Teachers having difficult time just to teach because of the behavior of the students. And our kids are the ones going to suffer. Even an ox knows its owner. A donkey recognizes its master's care, but Israel doesn't know its master. Wow. We don't seem to recognize his care. So rather than follow Father Yah's instructions through the prophet, ancient Judah became lawless and irreverent. You see, and that was the basis of the reverse Exodus. They are returning to Africa in disobedience. You just read Jeremiah 41, chapter 41 to chapter 46. Read it. Babylon was coming down on Judah, destroying the temple, taking his vestments. Judah became alarmed and terrified, frightened. Go to Jeremiah. Jeremiah, go to Father Yah and see and invite and ask what we should do. And everything he said, we going to do it. So here go Jeremiah, go on to Father Yah. Now, Lord, Judah, what should they do? Is what he says. Do not go back to Africa. Jeremiah come back and said, this is what he said. They said, no. He didn't tell you that, Jeremiah. We going. And you know what happened next. And you know the rest of the story. He said, the very thing you're trying to escape will overtake you. You'll be a byword. You'll be an astonishment. Even an ox knows its owner. A donkey recognizes master care, but Israel doesn't know his master. And this is an indictment, man. My people are foolish. They don't know me, says Yah. They are, oh my God, listen to this. They are stupid children who have no understanding. They are clever enough at doing wrong, but have no idea to do right. We get all puffed up and swole up. And things won't go our way the way we think it ought to be, rather than becoming what? Submissive. Allowing yourself to be shaped by the powers of God's creative hand and genius to mold you into a functional and useful servant. We get angry and go home and we sit. And you wonder why your life is such a chaotic mess. Clever enough to do wrong, but have no idea how to do right. On your best day, you mess up. You have to guard your mind even in church to stay on the things of God, because Satan loves to distract you. It And I want you to get the word of Father Yah deep in the recesses of your spirit, in your mind, and your heart. You want your life to be a perpetual cycle of distractions, that you would never realize the potential that you can become and the power of God, Yah, to shape and reshape your life into a functional and thought functional purposes. Hallelujah. Unfortunately, many of our people today exhibit a similar behavior of our ancient ancestors, Judah. We just like them. They our ancestors. We just like them. Many of our people, man, seemingly were without any desire to know, obey, and live according to Father Yah's instruction. That's why you can't drag folks into a Bible class. I don't care how elementary it be. I don't care how simple the class is. You can't drag them. They don't want the word. They don't want the word. And that's the problem. How are you going to know how to live dynamically? How you going to know how to function as Father Yah desire? Because everything is in his word. No word, no God, no God, no power. That's fact. Judah, no desire to know, no desire to obey, no desire to live according to his instruction in his holy word. Zion, we can do better. Zion, we must do better. If the church is becoming nothing but a senior citizen home, we got problems. If young adults are not grounding their children in the word of God, you are doing your child a disservice. What does Proverbs say? Train up a child in the way they should go. When they get old, they would not what? Depart from it. Now, they may go out there and wild out, but there's something inside of them going to say, now, okay, you're going too far now. You need to get back. But when they have no word at all, they're not going to get it at school. What is the hope for our people? How many of you guys got that email I sent you? See, I subscribe to these right-wing sites so I can see what the thinking is. Did you read that? Other folks are preparing. We still jumping over benches and walking benches and doing cartwheels. Don't know who we are. Won't surrender our lives in the master's hand so he can reshape us. Therefore, Jeremiah, go down and warn Judah and Jerusalem. Say to them, this is what the Lord said, I am planning disaster for you instead of good. So turn from your evil ways, each of you, and do what is right. Family, listen to Judah's response. But the people replied, don't waste your breath. That's the way I feel sometimes about teaching. Does it really matter? All the stuff I give out, is it about really benefiting? Do they really care? Is it a waste of my time to spend the midnight hour and putting all this stuff together? Is it a waste of time? But the people replied, don't waste your breath. Listen to this, the arrogance. We will continue to live as we want to. Stubbornly following, good God of mercy, our own desires. You will say that to your God? What can be done with people like Judah? How can they be turned around? Oh, brothers and sisters, like the imperfect jar, Judah must be crushed into a lump of clay, and that's exactly what happened to Judah. Lion departed to reshape the clay into a useful vessel. Brother and sister, remember, what the potter makes depends on the quality of the clay. What Father Yah makes of his people, your life, my life, it depends upon our response, their response. What he makes of our lives, it depends upon your response. So don't let Father Yah reject you. Don't let him reject your life as an unsuitable for his design and purpose. Don't let him shape evil against your disobedience. Instead, repent, surrender your life into his hand. He is the potter. You are the clay. He sees what you cannot see in your lives and what you can become. Brothers and sisters, Father Yah wants to make you his masterpiece. Why are you preventing him from transforming your life into his masterful work of art? He wants you to be his masterpiece. Remember, you are like the clay on the sacred wheel of God's creation. He alone sees your imperfection. He alone provides the power to transform your life and help you to live as his redeemed people. Yes, family, the clay is always in the potter's hand. Therefore, I don't know about you. I want him to shape and reshape my life. The choir used to sing a song, "Work on me. Work on my mind so I can think right. Work on my heart so I can love right. Work on my hand so I can give right. Work on my feet so I can walk right. Because when he gets through working on me, I'm going to come out like a functional vessel for his sacred purpose. Work on me." We need him to work on us today. Work on us so we don't become the object of his anger. Oh, work on our minds today, Father Yah. Help us to think right. Work on our hearts that we can love right. Our hands so we can give right. Our feet so we can walk right. But work on our tongues so we can talk right. Oh, Father Yah, don't give up on us. We know that we are the clay in your hands. And on the sacred wheel of your creation, we know you are looking at our imperfections. But you're not carrying that against us. Because you see our potentials, what we can become. And then, hallelujah, he gives us the power to live as his redeemed. Do you want him today to work on you? What imperfections do you think you see in your life that you know need to be changed? What things you know that Father Yah need to work on? That you may be transformed into this dynamic, useful, functional vessel for his spiritual purposes. Whatever those imperfections are, whatever they think you need in your life for him to change and rechange, guess what? It won't get changed until you surrender your life on the sacred wheel of his creation. Clay is always in the potter's hand. Otherwise, the clay would never become a useful vessel. If he removes his hand, the clay just collapses and falls. But I don't want Father Yah to give up on me. I want him to keep on working on me. Because one of these days, I'm going to come out like brand new gold. So when somebody look at me, they said, "Man, what happened to you?" And I can tell them ever since that day that I came out the wilderness of despair and sin, my soul been satisfied.
All the old preacher said, I looked at my hands, and my hand looked new. I looked at my feet, and they were too. And ever since that day, my soul been satisfied. I don't know about you, but I got to keep on running now. I got to see what the end gonna be. Oh, when I see him, I want to say thank you. Bringing me over the rough side of the mountain. Sometime up and sometime down. Almost level to the ground. But one Saturday morning, he came into my life. Took some old clay and molded it into his divine hand. And ever since that day, my soul been satisfied. I got to keep on running, Bishop. I got to keep on running, see what the end gonna be. Oh, when I see him today, I'm gonna say thank you. Thank you for molding my life. Thank you for changing my bad habits. Thank you. Keep on working on me. Keep on working on me, Father y'all. Because one of these days, I'm gonna come out like brand new gold. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, keep on working on us. If there's one today outside the ark of safety, and you know your life needs some shaping and reshaping, don't worry about what somebody else thinks. Think about what you need for your life. The doors open for reception of members by the letter of Christian experience of baptism. This is your time. Clay in the potter's hand.
Liturgy of the table. It is found in the back of your order service. Yours with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to Yah, our God. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, so now shall be. World without end. Confession, dear Yah, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We will not love you with all our hearts and soul, with all our mind and strength. We will not love our neighbor as ourselves. We ask you to forgive our sins through Yah. Yahshua HaMashiach of the Amen. Yah's ways that we have forgiveness. Through Yahshua, he offered cleansing and new life. The night in which the Savior Yahshua instituted the Lord's Supper, he added a new Seder, the Seder of the cup. So he took the bread, giving thanks to the Most High, and said to the disciple, "Break, eat all of this." That symbolizes my body broken for you. The cup, which was added to the Seder, symbolizes my blood shed for remission of your sins. And if all as we do this, we do show forth his death and suffering till he comes again. Come now to the Lord's table. Receive these elements as a reminder of the awesome price for our salvation. In turn, we bring him our gifts in gratitude and thanksgiving. Come now to the Lord's table. Thank you. pray you've been blessed and helped today by the word of the Most High. Clay in the potter's hand and shaping evil against the disobedient people. As you leave the day, remember, are you aware of the imperfection and spiritual blemishes in your life? And that's so important. But this is even more important. Have you surrendered your life to Father Yah like clay in the potter's hands? And lastly, what provisions are you making today for Father Yah to reshape your life? If Christ came today, would he find you a productive vessel servant for his use? How would he define you today? I pray and hope that you would invite him to work on you, your mind, your heart, your hand, your feet, and your tongues. Because when he gets through working on us, we will surely come out like brand new gold. May Father Yah bless and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom.